There's a word from the Lord, and I want us to go to the book of Acts, the 16th chapter of the book of Acts, looking at the 25th verse, the 16th chapter of the book of Acts. When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
Hear Peter's turn. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Now watch that. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul called with a loud voice, saying, "Do yourself no harm. For we are all here." Then he called for a light, ran in, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Let's just stop that. Well, let's look back up as we take in our seats. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. I want to use for some this morning, even having heard the testimony of the problems that folks have been set with all week long in these past 2 weeks. How do you handle a midnight? How do you handle a midnight? Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor,
neighbor.
Oh neighbor.
Oh neighbor.
How do you handle a midnight?" Turn to somebody else that they didn't hear you. Say, "Neighbor.
Neighbor.
Hey neighbor.
Neighbor.
How do you handle a midnight?"
Hey,
you got it. Let us pray. Eternal blessed God, we ask that you bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And Lord, help me not so much to preach a good sermon, but one that will do some good, so that the body of Christ may be edified by having heard it preached. In the glorious name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Amen.
How do you handle a midnight? Hearing all the testimonies and what have you, you know, I think it's apropos for this text to be read and properly exegeted this morning. When we talk about midnight, and midnight has multiple definitions when you think of midnight. Midnight is the hour after 11 p.m. Midnight is the hour before 1 a.m. Midnight on the clock is when both hands point up on 12. Midnight is the mid part of the night going into the day. Midnight sometimes is a dark hour, they say. Midnight is that hour just before a new day. Midnight is the hour just before or right there at the new year or the beginning of a new week. Midnight. But then there are other midnights that we can especially identify with. Midnight is a certain circumstance, a condition, or particular situation in our lives. Midnight. Have you had one before? Midnight is that time when, you know, you can have a midnight and it could be broad daylight out there and have a midnight in your life. You can be sitting right here in the church this morning, look at the at 12 o'clock noon, but still have a midnight in your life. I heard some of y'all talk about it even. Problems with our children. You experiencing a midnight. A midnight is when you've done the very best that you could. And then even your best is not good enough. And even when you've done all you could, and yet you end up failing no matter what best efforts you have put forth, you end up being unsuccessful. For you, that's midnight. Right. Midnight is when you've tried to do right, but even in the process of doing right, no good has come of it. That's midnight. Midnight is when you can have a job for many years and take care of your family depending on that job, only to later get word that in 6 weeks the company is no more. For you, that's midnight. Or single parent raising their children best they could, only y'all got time for this. Get a word from the job that your job has ended next week.
Amen.
And the bills are due, the rent is due, all kind of car note is due, the insurance bill is due, the phone bill is due, the light bill is due, and the no good daddy won't pay child. Things are going haywire in your relationships, and you found that one mate is not as honest as the other mate.
Amen.
And when you get a blow like that for you, that's midnight. And even our president, poor president, y'all got to pray for him.
Amen.
His signature achievement, the formal cap, rolls it out the 1st of October to only have glitches coming out the gate, and the Republicans not going to give him no hair. For him, that's midnight. Y'all got time. And then there's a judicial in midnight when here the Supreme Court guts a section of the Voters' Rights Act that was made in 1965, keeping states honest and not suppressing or denying folks to vote, but yet they got that portion. And now we're fighting for the right to vote. Fighting again, all of the same fights we had before the Civil War. Before the Civil Rights Movement, before the Voters' Rights Act was passed in 65, find ourselves fighting the same struggles over and over again. For us, it's midnight. On my way to the prison this morning, I shared this with Dr. Sill. I go down business 321 The traffic is a bit heavy as I approach the prison. There's an accident ahead. There are people directing traffic. The police out in the middle of the street, halting traffic and directing traffic. And I'm sitting there in my car. I said, I wonder what's going on. As I get a little closer to where the accident was, I look to my left, and that they had just pulled off with one ambulance, the EMS pulls off. There's two others there. But I look to the side. I look to see a wrecked car, wrecked vehicle sitting there. I look to see some people standing out, but only to see another EMS ambulance laying on its side. It had been in an accident. Now, let me show you this. Here, the rescuers that are on their way to rescue somebody else end up having to be the rescue. For them, that's midnight. Now, y'all bring it a little closer to home. Look at ourselves. Those of us that are trying to rescue folk. Yeah, I said, sometimes they make a wrong turn. And trying to rescue somebody else end up being the one that need to be rescued.
Amen.
For you,
amen.
That's midnight.
Amen.
Now in the text, you'll get time. As I'm going to read the text here, Paul was talking about going and preaching over in Asia Minor. And finally he has a vision of a man in Macedonia waving his hand, come over and help us. And Paul gets up from the vision. He gets his partner Silas and said, we must go to Macedonia. They ended up in a place called Philippi. As they're ministering, walking down the street. They're walking down the street. A little girl, a young woman, who had psychic powers, of whom her masters made money off of her. As they're walking down the street and pass her by, she turns around and sees Paul and Silas and began to follow them and said, these are the servants of the Most High God. And they come to give us direction of salvation. And kept on following them for days. Everywhere they turned, everywhere they went. This girl was following them until it irritated Paul and Silas. And Paul commanded the evil spirit to come out of her. And now, once he did that, she was normal, y'all. Just like everybody else. And now, not only that, it made for an economic tragedy for her owners. And now they could no longer make money off of her. And now they were upset and decided that they would do a citizen's arrest. And arrest Paul and Silas. I'm getting to where I need to be at. Y'all got time? Arrested Paul and Silas. Not only were they arrested, but they were beaten and thrown in jail. Now, there's a couple of things I want to say about that. You got to be careful about who's singing your praise?
Amen.
Who's bragging on you? Sometimes the wrong folk could be bragging on you and talking about you. You just had to get tripping. And then not only that, here was a woman that had excited, but she knew she wasn't telling the truth about who they were. She was. You understand? But the evil spirit in her irritated Paul and Silas. But now, let me ask can they say that you a servant of the Most High God? On your job, on the line that you're working in, can they say, I know that she is a servant, or he is a servant of the Most High? How many folk could say that about you and be telling the truth? You don't got time, you still got time. They're denied their human rights. They're denied their civil rights. This is a judicial tragedy here, because they're thrown in the prison and they had not committed a crime. Watch this here. And what I like about them is while they're thrown in the prison, they don't complain. They don't mumble. You know what I'm saying? They don't go, ooh, they got me wrong. They know there's a wrong. I look close and I can tell you. Who do they call? They're not calling for a doctor to bandage their wounds. They're not calling for an attorney to get them out. They're not calling for a bail bondsman. They're not calling the NAACP or the National Action Network with Al Sharpton to come and get them out for being unjustly incarcerated. They know how to get in touch with the divine company keeper. Here it is midnight for them. They have a judicial midnight. And they have a physical midnight. Here, they're being beaten, unjustly accused, incarcerated. A midnight for them. What do they do? Who do they call? But they know how to draw the attention. That's what you call here. Of the divine company keeper in the middle of their midnight. Watch the text. Said about midnight while they're in jail. No way out. They began to pray and sing hymns to the Lord. Now that they draw their attention now. See, they're not complaining, but they know how to draw in the middle of their midnight. They began to pray and say, here, what? I heard one old preacher said, Paul had a conversation with Silas and said, Silas, look here. Since my name starts with a P, I'll pray. And since your name starts with a sing, S, you sang. You know what I'm saying? That sounds good, but that old preacher was a little wrong there, because when I looked at the text, the text said, see, you would think that they just sang, you know what I'm saying? Or Paul prayed and Silas said, but when you look at that, the text said, they prayed and sang hymns. No, they did that. Go back again. The text said, they prayed and sang hymns. Now, in other words, they did a duet. They weren't doing no solo, and a problem with a whole lot of us is that we want to go solo. We want to have to step solo. You know what I'm saying? I can do it all by myself. I don't need no help. I don't need you. I don't need no mentor. I don't need no sponsor. I don't need no problem. I don't need nobody solo. And why we in the mess? Let me stay here.
Amen.
Try to do it solo. Just like you need somebody to pray with you. You need a prayer partner. You understand? Sometimes your prayer might be a little weak to get to it, so you have somebody else praying. They can boost the prayer on
God.
You understand? And effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And so nobody in a woman is an island in time of himself. Everybody's part of the man. You need somebody to call and say, I got trash on my brain here. And I need somebody to talk to. I'm going through. And I need to talk to you. You can't do it by yourself. The text said in the midnight hour, they pray. I don't know why. I would say, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. You don't know what they pray, but they pray. You know, they try to do it. And I don't think that they would ever meet it out, Job, if they didn't have one another. Paul needed Silas, and Silas needed Paul. See, it is like you want to need some folks. You understand? I know we got some super folks here, super Christian things. They don't need nobody else. How to do it all by myself. People need people. You understand? You need other folks. You need other folks to talk. Or you need other folks as a sounding board. Word of God said they're seated in a multitude of counselors. The text goes on. They sang. And see, not just praying, but see, in the midnight, you pray and you find a happy song. The saint, you understand? Rather than sit in the corner and start singing the blues, my baby done left me and I don't know what I'm going to. You understand? Say, put a happy song. They might say, we come by this far by faith, leaning on the everlasting arm. You know what I'm saying? Because all that movement was a faith move. They had a faith walk. Every move they made, it was moved, they moved in faith. Yeah. Or they might say, amazing grace, how sweet to say, that saved the rest like me. It was grace. Yeah. Yes. That they were living. It was grace that was bringing them along. Yeah. Here, they sang, they prayed, they sang, they prayed, they sang. Here, a light went to move us to see 12 years of slave. Y'all see it? Now just come out. You'll see that. Listen, a man who had been a musician, playing in some of the finest places, what have you. A free man in the 1800s. And now he goes and has some drinks with some friends and ends up in a bed, and they put him in the bed, and that was the last scene. And when he wakes up, he's in chains. He's in stocks and chains. You understand? Legs, both legs, wrists in chains. He went to struggle and try to get out. And some slavers come in and said, boy, you're a runaway slave from Georgia. He said, no, I'm Daniel so-and-so, and I'm a free man. I said, boy, the heck you are. You are a runaway, and you don't sass us. Took him, put him in the car, carried him to Georgia, and sold him as a slave. This is a true story. Now, while he's trying to petition to everybody he knows, all the slave owners, and you know, they said, boy, he was educated, he spoke, he talked about the place where he said, boy, don't you never hear me. He let us hear you talk like that. We'll hang you. Had him inside. Petitioning everybody good. And as the slavers would sing songs, he wouldn't join in. He was in this dilemma trying to figure out a way, and he knew that he wasn't a slave. And somebody told him, said, look, you better get on board. You better get with it, or he going to kill you. He didn't know how to get through until after a few funerals down the street. They were burying some folk in the grave, and them folks came together. And one of the old women of the slave plantation hit a song off and got to singing. And he just kept, he didn't know what he just confused. Just about to lose his mind. Up in here, up in here. You understand? Singing one of them songs right along with them. And he starts singing louder and louder and louder and louder. And I believe that helped him, Terry, get over. That helped him to last a little while longer. Until he was able to get free. See, sometimes we got to sing a song. And hold on just a little while longer. Until we're able to get free. You want to get through your midnight? Oh, see, he looked, went from pain to praise. In the midst of the pain, they got to pray and they got to sing. And all of a sudden, while they sang and while they prayed, guess what? The Lord heard the prayers and heard the songs. And all of a sudden, so I'm going to send an earthquake down there. And the earthquake showed up and shook the jail off its foundation. And the doors of prison, in the midst of that midnight, swung wide open. And I'm talking about the power of prayer. I'm talking about the power of praise. Here the foundation of the prison shook. Don't swung wide open. And the jailer had been asleep. And remember, early in the text, he said, they sent them to the jail and said, you secure these men. In other words, what that means to me, they put them in the hole. You know, you secure them as you're in the prison, but when they tell the jailer to secure you, that means you're going to go to the jail inside the jail. Huh? That's the hole. So you're going to lock down. You ain't supposed to free. And all of a sudden, the jailer wakes up. And he figures they all had left. And he now takes the sword, getting ready to kill himself. And listen to Paul. Said, do thyself no harm, man. We all here. And the jailer, now, watch this. The same one that whipped him is now asking, what should I do? Even confuse your enemies.
Right.
He'll make the word of God said, he'll make your enemies your footstool. Yeah. Look at him in the same one that just got through whipping. Said, what must I do? And how often times are we there asking the proverbial question, what must I do? Kids out of mind, what must I do? Money short, what must I do? Folk ain't acting right. I ain't being treated right. What must I do? I'm being looked over. What must I do? Trouble to my right, trouble to my left. What must I do? And the answer came back. It's in the text. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe that he's right there with you in the midst of your midnight. Believe that he's right there with you in the midst of your troubles. Believe and trust that he's there when things go haywire in the house. Believe that he's with you when your money's short. Believe in his presence when you're sick. Believe in the Lord. Trust.
Amen.
In the Lord. Let me leave you with one thing here. Man was having a conversation with God. And he said, God, you said that you would be with me always. He said, but when I look back over my life, I saw that there were times where there were two sets of tracks. And even though you said that you would be with me, you understand? Then there were times when I looked at my calendar and I checked the record. There were some days where there would only be one set of tracks. Lord, I want to know what happened. Where were you at? You said that you would be with me. And the Lord turned and smiled at him. Said, son, I'm glad you asked. Said, you know, yes, there were some days when there were two sets of tracks. And those days when there were two sets of tracks, they were yours and mine. But then there were days even when there were two sets of tracks. There were days when you had money in your pocket. They were yours and mine. When you had a good job, they were yours and mine. Days when you had your bills paid up, they were yours and mine. Days where your children didn't give you no trouble, they were yours and mine.
Amen.
But the days that you saw one set of track, they were mine. Because it was me carrying you. Because he'll carry you
up.
Regardless of what your midnight is this morning, remember, he's carrying you.
Yes.
And he'll keep on carrying you till he comes again.
Amen.